So I just decided to reconnect to home. I think it's a cool background, just dilapidated Empire City. Fits really well with what I'm talking about as I read excerpts from this book, Rachel and Her Children, Homeless Families in America. This is the 9th video from it, and in this video I'm going to read excerpts from pages 147 to 153. I don't think I'll be able to reach to page 153 in this particular video, so that's probably going to have to continue on the next video. Anyway, I shall start. Autumn 1986. This is the date that he actually went to here and experienced this. The building that houses the City Central EAU is on Church Street in Lower Manhattan. EAU is the emergency aid unit, assistant unit, I believe. It's like the emergency shelter system. At about 11:30 on night in late November, I watch a woman walk into this building. Dark-eyed, pregnant, carrying some paper bags of clothing, Susan comes into the room with a good deal of hesitation. Her husband, a tall man with reddish hair, walks beside her. Seated in one of the molded plastic chairs, she holds a crumpled tissue in her hands. When she isn't weeping, she leans back and shuts her eyes and twists the Kleenex in her hands. She and her husband, both of whom appear to be in their late 20s, do not speak to each other, but stare at a TV set fixed to the wall before them. I later learned that she is 8 months pregnant. They've been staying in the home of friends. Their friends, already overcrowded, have been threatened with eviction if they stay. They were finally asked to leave. They've been here before. They've been at other shelters. They haven't had a real home for 6 months. She sits patiently, crying some and coughing a great deal. On the wall above her head, there are some of these printed words. If you are eligible for emergency housing, you will receive referral to shelter and transportation to get there. If you do not accept the shelter and transportation you are offered, you will have to leave. Near the sign, there is another, somewhat more alarming. It advises families who have formerly been placed in one of the city's largest family shelters that their children, 6 years or younger, should be tested for lead poisoning. The shelter, nearby on Catherine Street, has been in the news a great deal recently. Opened in December 1985, it was founded in February 1986 by the Legal Aid Society to be hazardous to children and to pregnant women. The New York City Health Department noticed that the water heater leaked carbon monoxide. The kitchen was strewn with garbage. Heating facilities for food were found to be inadequate. An outbreak of infant diarrhea, 25 cases in 1 week, had been noted by residents and provoked the city's health inspection. The city at first declined to close the shelter because, officials said, the problems weren't life-threatening. In March, a pediatrician from Montefiore Hospital had studied the shelter. Terming the conditions there abominable, he reported that the walls were covered with lead paint. Paint was also flaking off around the window sills and the radiators within the reach of children. Worse, large chips of paint removed by painters during renovation had been left in open piles and plastic bags where children and adults could breathe the lead. The paint on the walls, examined by an independent testing agency hired by Legal Aid, contained 10 times the amount of lead permitted by law, according to Legal Aid attorney. Contamination from exposed asbestos had also been present. Children and adults, the doctor said, had been endangered since the shelter opened. The city refused to close the shelter until April, when it was so ordered by the courts. It reopened the shelter in September, but instead of getting rid of the lead poison, it has simply covered it with lead-free paint. This cannot prevent the further flaking off of chips, which may expose a child to the poison that remains beneath. The chairman of pediatrics at State University Health Science Center in Brooklyn supplied some added information. Medical treatment of lead-poisoned children, he observed, is generally disappointing because it occurs after the fact of brain damage. Damage to intellectual function, he added, is often irreversible. Using children to discover bad housing is analogous, he said, to the use of canary by coal miners to discover noxious fumes. We can afford to lose some canaries in a good cause. Subjecting children to such tasks, he said, was not appropriate. The city, however, continued to send families to the shelter. Almost 500 people, over half of whom were children, were still housed at Catherine Street in late November. The HRA agreed that pregnant women and children under 7 would not be placed there. Susan tells me she is a high school graduate and had a clerical job before becoming pregnant. Her husband, who held a low-paid job, live with her and their daughter in an apartment that her father helped to pay for. Evicted after her father's death, she has been homeless since. 10 days with friends, 2 weeks in one homeless shelter, 2 weeks in another. She's been on her feet for half a year, riding at night on subways to the EAU, going at 2 or 3 o'clock to a hotel. Her rent allowance when her child is born will be $244. Because of this location, she has lost her Medicaid. She hasn't been housed in any one location long enough to get herself enrolled in WIC, or Women's Infant Care. I don't know the acronym, but it's the age you get when you're pregnant and with children. She expects her child in 3 weeks. She has not received prenatal care. Last week, she says, she came here twice. Her child, who is 6, was with her. I slept here 2 nights on that bench. They let my daughter use the crib. They gave her tuna fish and juice. The first night, after having waited until 5 a.m., she and her daughter had been sent to Catherine Street. At Catherine Street, they wouldn't let me stay. They don't take pregnant women. They let me sleep there in some kind of office on a cot. We had to leave after about an hour. The next night, when they told her they were sending her to Catherine Street again, she grew alarmed. I wouldn't go. They put me in handcuffs over there. They said I was upset. Handcuffs for a pregnant woman who refuses to be sent into a shelter where the city has already promised not to send a pregnant woman seems a bit extreme. When she tells me, almost with embarrassment, they said I was upset, I think of certain women who are close to me, my mother, sister, and friends. I try to picture what they do or say in such a situation. She points to a corner of the room. I threw her up right over there. At 1 a.m., a man dressed in a suit and tie, a handsome overcoat and hat, opens an office door and comes to speak with her. He asks her why her daughter isn't here. She answers that she left her child with her mother. For some reason, this disturbs him. He tells her this was irresponsible. She explains that she was here last week for 2 nights with her daughter. They sent me to Catherine Street. They wouldn't let me stay. My daughter couldn't sleep. She says she thought that it was more responsible to leave her daughter with her mother, who agreed to keep the child for the night. Once they find a place for her to live, she'll bring her daughter. The man's response is puzzling. Is there something here that I don't understand? This is irresponsible, he says again. I'll bet that you won't show up at your welfare office in the morning. You'll get there late. Tomorrow night, I'll see you sitting here again. He shakes his finger inches away from her eyes. There's something lacking in you. You have to be up at 7 a.m. You have to get back into your welfare office. Over his head, there is printed warning about Catherine Street. Here you are. It's after midnight. How much sleep do you expect to get? Intimidated by his words, weary with 6 months of sleeplessness, recurrent nausea, aching limbs, she looks down at the floor. He lectures her again about her irresponsible behavior. She looks up at the sign above his head. The man's demeanor, self-assured, impeccable, bewilders me. He seems convinced that he is doing something good for Susan by reducing her to tears. Destructive forms of conscientiousness, wrote Eric Erickson, the most deadly of all possible sins. At 1:20, another man emerges from an office. We're sending you to Catherine Street, he says. Do you accept? She shakes her head. Then you refuse? Again, she shakes her head. He disappears into the office. At 2 a.m., the second man returns. It seems they have relented. They're sending her instead to a hotel in Queens. He drops into her hand 4 subway tokens. She had admonished to be at her welfare office with her child in 7 hours. With the help of her husband, she gets up from the plastic chair. Her husband hands her one of their paper bags. An elderly policeman who has been observing this steps forward to assist her as he straightens up her back. She thanks him, and in doing so, her face relaxes for the first time in 2 hours into a real smile. When I recruit, you know what? Yeah, the next page, next 2 pages, I'll continue in the next video. Because it's not going to make it into the 11-minute time limit. But just think about this story for a while, you know? About the woman who comes into this welfare office. And how... just how it is. Just what I read. Just think about that. I'm not going to say anything more than that.